people. No more shame. 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 Say no more shame. No more shame. No more shame.
Take your seat, choir.
In those days, wedding ceremonies were prolonged festivals. Today, when we do weddings, we do it for a couple of hours. But in those days, when weddings are celebrated, they are celebrated for weeks. 3 weeks, 2 weeks, 1 month. It depends on how blessed or financially capable that the bridegroom is, that wedding should be celebrated. Number two, in those days, it was an error for you to reject invitations to wedding. It was an error. It was an insult. Am I talking to somebody here? It was an insult for you to reject invitations to wedding. Just the way it's an insult for you to be unsaved and an altar call is called and you are sitting down. It's an insult for you not to be born again and a minister calls for an altar call and you are still well seated. Anything you need in life, if the cross is not involved, it has no future. Anything you need in life, if the cross is not involved, it has no tomorrow. Anything you need in life, whatever you want to become, it is not on the premise of the cross. One time, I was studying the life of Samson, and God spoke to me. He said, when Samson was about to die, he did everything, his eyes were cut off. When the enemy captures you, the first thing he kills is your vision. A man whose vision is taken out, he will end up as a pepper grinder. The enemies begin to manipulate you, and they garaged him to a corner. And the Bible says, Samson stood and said to a young lad, let me feel the pillars. He put his right hand on one pillar, his left hand on the other pillar. And God told me, he says, stand and do that. What does this stand for? The cross. Samson initiated the cross. As soon as the cross showed up, the Bible said those he killed in his lifetime were more than those. Those he killed at his death, their mothers, those he killed in his lifetime, just like Jesus on the cross, those he saved at his death, their mother, those he saved at his lifetime. There is something you must know about invitation. He said Jesus was invited to the marriage, and the people had no wine. Ladies and gentlemen, the Bible didn't say the people ran out of wine. In those days, when you are doing, if you are doing a celebration for few hours, for few hours now, you carry drinks. So imagine somebody doing a celebration for 2 weeks, 3 weeks. They had no wine. Not that they ran out of wine. It means somebody stole the wine. Somebody hijacked the wine. Somebody says, since I couldn't stop this couple from coming together, let me cause shame in their midst. Since they couldn't stop you from getting married, let them try to cause barrenness and miscarriage. I tell people, when they miscarry, I say it's not the end of the world. If you miscarry, it's a sign that you can carry. If you miscarry, you can recarry. Am I talking to somebody here? So if you have miscarried before, it's a sign that you can recarry. It doesn't matter what is militating against the fruitfulness of your life. It doesn't matter what the devil has fired into your reproductive organ. Listen to me. If you're in this service here, there are things that will come out of your body physically. Anything that is not of God, Jesus said, whatever my Father has not planted, it shall be uprooted. Isaiah 59:19. So shall they fear the name of the Lord from the west, and his rising from the going down of the sun. For when the enemy shall come like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord shall raise up a standard against him. I prophesy with this mouth I used to pray, as you hear the sound of my voice. Anyone that has tempered with your celebration, their assignment is terminated. Your assignment is terminated. Your assignment is terminated. Somebody shout fire.
Fire.
Take your seats. the enemy comes to bring shame. That was why when David, pastor, when David got to a point, David said to himself, they brought a battle. It was the Philistine that set a battle in array against Israel. And who was leading them? Goliath. David, first of all, asked of his identity before he confronted him. It was when David understood his identity that he knew that this man was not supposed to be here. Because Goliath means exile. That's why I said, who is this man? When they told him Goliath, he said, exile. Ah! That makes the battle easy for me. I know that this man is not supposed to be around here at all. And he said, what shall be done for the man that kills this uncircumcised Philistine? He didn't say, how shall I kill him? What shall be done? In other words, it's a settled matter. This time, what was he saying? He said, this time you must pay me. I killed the lion free of charge. Nobody pay me. I killed the bear free of charge. Nobody pay me. To kill Goliath, they must pay me. There are certain things now you are doing in the secret. As a pastor, nobody is paying you. You are fasting, nobody is seeing you. You are studying, nobody is seeing you. Very soon, when results begin to manifest, they have to pay you. Am I talking to somebody? For your years of labor, your years of pain, what shall be done for the man that destroys? And they told him three things. The three things that cover human life. Number one, he said the king will give him great riches, material blessing. Ego neku. Money. Number two, the king will give him his daughter for a wife, helpers, all capacity of helper. Number three, his father's house shall be free forever, no more foundation. These are the three things that cover a man's destiny when he sends his enemy on exile. Am I talking to somebody right now? These are the three things that cover a man's life. And Saul said to David, you are too small to confront Goliath. Let me tell you about Goliath's curriculum vitae. He said, number one, Goliath has been a warrior since he was a youth. Number two, Goliath's sword is bigger than you two times. Number three, Goliath has never lost any battle. And David said, King Saul, you are looking for CV. Let me give you CV. There was a time I kept my father's flocks. A lion came, I tore the lion. There was a time I kept my father's flock. A bear came, I tore the bear. Let me give you CV. The God that delivered me out of the mouth and the hand of the lion, he will deliver me from this Goliath. I don't know the giant in front of you, but I know there is a bigger God. I don't know the giants contending you, but I know there is a bigger God. You don't serve a dead God. You serve a mighty God. He's the same yesterday. He's the same today. He's the same forever. When God say yes, no man can say no. When God lifts you up, no man can bring you down. God is on your side. Power is on your side. Glory is on your side. Angel, one shot fire. Many years ago, a lady was blind for 29 years, and I finished preaching. People were healed, miracles happened, and I said, it's time to close. The woman shouted from back, close. And now they see, oh, will they close? Yeah, will they close? Go. Are they here first day? People, why not they see? I go here second day. People, why not they see? Today, not third day. I know they see. You say, will they close? And the daughter said, mommy, keep quiet. Keep quiet. If I go outside, go see. Is they close? So I moved to her. I said, mama, we won't close. Don't worry, God go do him. He said, no, me do him now. I said, mama, you they see me? He said, no, 29 years. 29 years. I know they see. And I turned back. As I was leaving, the daughter whispered to her. He said, pastor, they go. He said, they say you they go. You they go? I say, mama, not be me go heal you now, Jesus. He said, where am? I said, they near you. And she prayed a prayer that touched me. Jesus, open my eye. Jesus, open my eye. Jesus, open my eye. Jesus, open my eye. The next thing I heard was, wait. Wait. I don't see people.
Oh.
I don't see people.
Oh.
I don't see people. Wait. Can I prophesy? If you can get rebelliously stubborn and brutally angry, it is a crime for you to live here paralyzed. It is an error for you to live here with fibroid. It is an error for you to live with cancer. It's an error for you to live with HIV. It's an error for you to live with tumor. I am Alaba. I shall take care of people. It's an error to live with hepatitis B. I challenge that sickness. I challenge barrenness. I need pastors at the emergency. I need pastors at the emergency. I need pastors at the emergency. As I'm talking now, cripples are walking. As I'm talking now, blind is seeing. As I'm talking now, paralyzed rise up. Deaf ear be open. Don't begin to speak. Let there be miracles. Let there be signs. Let there be wonders. I prophesy. Right where you are, miracles happen. Miracles. Miracles. They say you can't carry a baby. Carry twins. Carry twins. They say you can't be prosper. I open the treasury of heaven. I open the bank of heaven. Let money enter your account. Let money enter your account. Let money enter your life. Power of God. Release miracle money. Power of God. Release wedding. Power of God. Release marriage. Carry your wedding gown. Carry your wedding gown. Carry your wedding gown. Carry your wedding suit. Carry your wedding gown. I see your settlement. I see favor. I see favor. I see miracle. Down. No more shame. Sit down. A kapala to totash. Ah! Right where you are. Whoever has tempered with the process of your laughter. Whoever has tempered. I am Ashanda Baha. You study your Bible. You study your Bible. You discover. Stop that. Stop her. Stop her. Stop her. Stop her. Stop her. You study. Hey, stop that. You study your Bible. You discover as soon as Jesus got that confirmation in verse 11, this beginning of miracles did Jesus in Cana of Galilee and showed forth his glory. His disciples believed on him. Next two chapters, he was led to the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. For you to be a man of God, you must be challenged by situation, approved by God, confronted by the devil. Challenged by situation, approved by God, and confronted
by the devil. Situations will challenge you to test your belief in the one that called you. People think being a man of God exempts them from problem. It's actually an invitation to problem. As soon as Job finished sacrificing for his children, he lost them. Confronted by the devil. One of the most shocking encounters I've experienced in my life or heard was an encounter with a man of God in the north. That encounter shook me. Nothing has shaken me like that. The demons of hell were after his life. And one day when he traveled, a demon took his form. He traveled, he went for a crusade. A demon took his form, his body form, his suit, his briefcase, and went to go and meet his wife. His form, everything, even the little mark he has on his face, the demon took the briefcase, went to meet his wife. The wife said, "Only welcome." He said, thank you, darling. The husband was in the program. It was a demon. He said, "Only, but I thought you were supposed to come after 3 days." He said, the way the program went, I'm had to come back. Now, if you are the one, your husband is back, will you call the host to confirm? You won't call anybody now. That one came. The woman noticed that there was a strange presence. He said, "Honey, there's something about this house." Man said, "Don't worry, come to the bed." "Come to the bed? You are just coming?" She said, This doesn't look like my husband. This doesn't sound okay. Good wife. While she was going to the bed, a phone rang. The phone rang. Who was calling? The husband. The husband said, "Baby, I just had to call you. How are you?" "Hello? Baby, how are you?" Another voice. "Baby, come to the bed. Baby, how are you?" She was confused. "Are you calling me from the room?" He said, "Which room?" "I'm in the program. We'll just finish a session. How are you? How are the kids?" "But you're in the house." He said, "Which house?" The woman put up the phone. But they said, "Come now." She picked. He said, "Honey, you are in the house and you are calling. What's going on?" There was nothing she knew at that point. Other than kibarata kata pata kata pata kata kata lapa kata kata prakata lokoto prakata prakata kata leketi prakato kate. "Lord, I don't know what's going on. I don't know what's happening." Kapata rokata. The man disappeared. The briefcase disappeared. The suit disappeared. And the husband said, "What's going on?" She told the husband. The husband said, "From today, anywhere they travel, you they follow me. Let me see how they will appear in my presence." Am I talking to somebody here? The devil has gone that far. What's going on?
Papa, miracles are happening.
Tell me, don't waste my
time. Where you were ministry just now, the power of God came heavily upon this man. He has been blind since 2006. He said as soon
10
as...
10 years.
10 years blindness disappear on the spot. 10 years blindness. Papa, sir. He said the eyes, doctor said they were completely damaged.
Doctor said the eyes
are damaged after operation.
Don't hold the mic like that. Hold it down. Yes.
He was operated upon in 2006 and was the eye became damaged, could not see with the eye. He was totally blind. The person that led him here is outside, handed him over to the usher that he was tired. So the usher helped him to the emergency session. So while you were ministering, Papa, he placed his hand on the eye because you are saying miracles are happening. Miracle. That was when he stood up, he said, I can see. So I examined him.
Where is he from? Ask him where he comes from.
I come from Ohi. Ohi, yes.
What's Ohi?
Ohi.
Is there a place like that?
Yes.
What's your address?
Okay. Ohi, that's in Omoha.
What's your address? Where do you stay?
Okay, my address.
It's a village.
It's a village.
What's your name?
My name is Goswell Okoro.
Now, listen.
This is real. Wherever you are, carry the same power. Pastors, come back to the altar. Pastors, come back to the altar. We'll take testimonies later. I know some. Look, I see they are stealing this from people. No, later we'll take the testimonies. Huh? A lot of testimonies. No, let's take it after the message. After the message. Give the Lord a hand for all of these miracles.
Hallelujah.
After the message. After the message.
Hallelujah.
Take your seat. Hold on, let me give you a background. The Bible says, when Jesus was through with the miracle, when the governor, somebody shout governor. It is a governor that will share your testimony. It was a governor that tasted the wine. I say it's a governor that will share your testimony. You will see an excellency, a president. He will say, hey, I saw one man from my state. Something happened for him. Hey, I saw one woman that was a businesswoman. She's now the one borrowing money to the state. She's now the one giving the state 20 billion, 30 billion. Hey, it's a president that will share your testimony. I say it's a president that will share your testimony. They gave the wine to a governor. To test it. And the Bible says, the governor said, you have brought the sweet wine now. This one is sweeter. When favor comes, your life is sweeter than before. How do I exterminate shame from my life? The Bible says, and Jesus was invited. Tell somebody, invite Jesus. Churchianity is not Christianity. Now your parents started in the church. Your grandfather was in the church. You now came through that church. You are baptized. You are confirmed and confused. That does not mean you know Christ. There are many of you are going to churches because your parents went there. Not because you, and that's one of the problem of the East. They are going to church because their father went there. Salvation is not family affair. Work out your own salvation. With fear and trembling. You don't go to a church because your parents are there. You go to a church because God revealed the man to you. You go to a place because it's revealed to you. Sometimes you must be a rebel with a curse. When David rebelled, they said, you are a rebel. He said, is there not a curse? I can be a rebel with a curse.
Salvation!
I'm telling you that many of you carrying chaplet and scapula on your neck. You don't know God. I don't have a problem with scapula. I don't have a problem with chaplet. But let the right person wear it. Some of you carrying, even some of you in Pentecostal churches, in choir, in prayer band. You're in prayer band, you are keeping malice. You're in choir, you are dating yourselves. You are a deacon and you are a witch, deacon wizard. A pastor was poisoned and he was in the hospital. The church is like 25 minutes from our location. And I said to him, don't worry, I will dash him from our church. Then we are under a batcher. I said, I will dash him from our church to your place. When I got there, I took the anointing oil. I said, a number about 12 or so of you conspired to poison your pastor. You conspired and poisoned. They poisoned him with fufu. That's why if you eat too much, it's a problem. God gave you hands to lay on the sick. I use the hand to bless Aku. Foodfulness destroys fruitfulness. Foodful. Destroys fruitfulness. To continually fill your stomach is to gradually empty your destiny. And when we got there, I said, come out. A few people came out. Two of them were ordained ministers. They came out. I anointed the doors. I say, if you don't come out, anybody that crosses the door will go mad. As you are crossing the door, you start tearing your clothes. You will go mad. So seven came out. After service, five women refused to go home. So they told them, you will come out, want to close church. They say, close it. Cross, come out. They say, no, you know, see oil for ground, close the church. And the usher said, today you must go out. You must cross that oil. Share you people refuse to, you must cross the oil. What am I emphasizing? These were leaders in church. I mean, a few pastors are too much in a hurry to give people position. Because you think if you don't make them deacon, they will go. Oh, go. So you have to rush. Make them, that donation should not bring ordination. Donation should not bring ordination. I have a man in my church who blesses me in millions. I don't ordain me. I can't ordain him. I told you, I said, me ordain you. It's not possible. Bring the seed. I'll collect it, but I will not ordain you. He said, Papa, I don't even want to. I don't want. He said, I know my life. If you ordain me now, you complicate my problem. See, I'm better like this. Let me be looking for God. Just be serving God. A man dropped $1 million. What's $1 million? And then you pour oil on his head. Oil! That is priceless. Oil. We have missed it. And a governor, what was even governor? A local government chairman will come to your church and you print him B and put him there. Look, what is local government chairman? Chairman of local people. A local government chairman is the chairman of local people. And you put him there. That's rubbish. One time, I do my counseling like this. I do my counseling in public because of some experience. So I do counseling openly. I don't counsel. When I'm doing declared counseling, I do it in public. People sit down. So one day, we are sitting down. I just saw a man, siren and all, and policemen, security were just coming. Blah, blah, blah. He was coming straight. In the former regime, he was just coming straight. So he came to me. See, Apostle, how are you? People were on the queue. See, Apostle, how are you? I said, fine. He said, I think you should know me. I said, yeah, you know Governor of San Jose State. He said, yes. I said, go to the queue. He said, I am go. I said, go to the queue. Didn't you meet people here? Is this government house? Go to the queue. So he said, I said, you, they will throw you outside. Join Oga. Stand behind Oga. I waited. When he was getting to his turn, I said, I was tired. I said, Your Excellency, get another date. I'm tired. I can't counsel you now. When you go to their government house, they keep you waiting. They come to church. Let them wait. We have to make them respect men of God. How much are they giving you? Money we finish, but integrity is an internal currency. Even if it's Gary, you have to drink it with dignity. They're going to line up under one man. Under one man who is not supposed to be an usher in your church. Rubbish. How much does he have to give you? How much? One time, we went, hey God, thank you, Jesus. One time, we went to a governor's place. I parked my car very far. You see my car that time, Now let me the start the car. Normally, that car, I leave the key on the ignition till daybreak. You can't steal it. You cannot steal the car. I know they come out here. I'll just leave the key inside. If you are a thief, do your wish. Because the car, before it starts, it will laugh. It will laugh. It will cough first. You turn it. No, you turn it like this. You hit it. You turn it. You hit it. Like the third time. You turn it. You hit it. Then we first of all cough. So, thank you, Jesus. Oh, Jesus is sweet. So what happened? Let me tell you a story. What happened was one governor called me. I just got married 2 years. And I told my wife, I said, I'm not going. My wife said, they will say you are proud. You know, people don't understand pride from confidence. They will say you are arrogant. So go. I said, I'm not going. He said, go. I said, with this car. When I went, I now parked my car very far. And I walked to the governor's place. If you see my mouth, for sharp. Your Excellency, knee down. No, to make matters worse, he opened the Bible, he was showing me. He said, this is Dick's Bible. Do you know it? As a child, me, if I know Dick's Bible. As Your Excellency, it's not about Bible, it's about doing what is inside the Bible. Not showing me Bible. I said, knee down. He said, eh? I said, knee down. He knelt down. I put hand on his head. I said, Father. I started tapping his head. All the money of the state, this man's collection. I said, nobody can talk to you. The advice is my only listen. This is my opportunity. I said, knee down. He knelt down for a while. You know, when you kneel down, after a long time, you now sit down. He now sat down. I said, SLS, knee down. God is doing something in your life. Just stay there. Knee down like that. After a while, I said, Father, pah! He said, shh. I said, it's the anointing. Stubborn man. You know the hear what? This is your head. So I put my hand like that. Jesus is good. At the end, I don't get no money. We are now going. They now package 6 million. I didn't have a car. When they brought the money out, I saw they gave it to one of our pastors. Then, you know, and they gave it to him. Daddy, bag. I said, Daddy, we don't hammer. I said, hammer. How much? I said, 6 million. I said, return it. He said, sir, 6 million. I said, that period, I didn't have 500,000. I didn't have 200,000. I said, return it. Say, sir, 6 million. I say, return. What did we do? Did we do contract? Why is he giving us money after prayer? Why didn't he bring it before the prayer? So he's paying for the prayer. Return it. The man returned it. Where we're now going, the governor is now escorting me to my car. I say, Jesus, Jesus, let this man turn back. Let this man, not lie. The man, they follow me. When we're going to my car, I wanted to pass my car. He was following me, so I turned back. He says, is this your car? I say, yes. This is your car. I say, yes. I say, yes, I will see you. He said, no, move. You have to move. This compliment is respectful. I allow you to move before I turn back. Hey, oh. My car started. I do it. I turn. I do it. I turn. I do it. He said, is there any problem? I said, no, Your Excellency. Do it. My car started. It started. When I turned, I was looking from Jesus, thank you. I was looking for at the mirror inside. He just said, and turn. Hi. You know, with all the boldness, that thing touched me. 2 years later, he invited me. I drove my car and I parked that car in front near his door. I came out. When he escorted me, wanted to turn back. I said, follow me down. When I brought your car, you follow me. Now, bring that car. You know what I'm saying? I saw the children. They were trying to open the door of my car because the car I was using was exactly their father's car. I said, no, that's not your father's own. It's my own. It's finer than your father's own. Your father's own is parked in front. I said, Jesus is good. And God told me, he said, if you had collected that money that time, I would not have blessed you to the level you have the same car with him. There are some monies you allow go today, but it brings more money tomorrow. Garri that is blessed is better than fried rice that is cursed. Am I communicating here? Invite Jesus. Invite Jesus. There might be trials. You know, when Jesus came here, they still ran out of wine. Relationship with God does not guarantee a trouble-free life. Relationship with God does not guarantee a life that is void of trouble, but relationship with God guarantee a life that always has solution. No matter the trouble you see, no matter the challenges that come your way, am I communicating here? There will always be a way out of it. There will always be a solution. When I gave my life to Christ, I was a mockery. I come from a Muslim family, former Muslim family. My father was an allergy. Today, my father is an elder. One day, I was praying. I said to God, I want to stop answering Suleiman. I want to change to Solomon. God said, no, I'm sending you as a rebel against that world. So leave that name the way it is. It's a model. Because I want to use you to put an end to what they are doing. To be a voice that will confront and challenge them. Am I talking to somebody right now? Because I was there. There is nothing there. If you see me rebellious and stubborn, it's because that's the only thing I got from there. Stubbornness is the only thing I collected. Ki. And nothing happens. Impunity, audacity, sarcasticity. Nothing happens. Listen to me. The entrance of Christ in a man's life. The entrance of Christ in a man's life. The first sign is peace. When you have no peace, you have no Christ. Peace. There are many of you looking at me now. You are a deacon in church. You can't sleep. You are afraid. You are scared. You don't have Jesus. Because when he comes, he brings peace. The sign. Once you say, Jesus, come into my life. The sign that he has come is that he gives you peace. No matter the experience. No matter what you are going through. You just notice there is peace. It gives you peace, and peace gives you hope that there's a better tomorrow. Am I communicating here? Am I communicating here? There were six empty water pots. If you must not see shame in your life, number two, agree that you are empty. The empty water pot was what produced the miracle. Admit that you are empty. Empty. Agree that by yourself you can do nothing. Your problem is that you think your education is what will make you a star. Some of you young ladies think you are going to get married because of your beauty and your catwalk and your all kinds of work, your pancake, your foundation, your Tara. Is it Tara or Terra? All kinds of foundation. People and ladies have gone far as putting their picture on internet looking for men. Snapping picture. See stupidity. One time I was in the plane and a girl was entering the plane and she did like this. Yeah. People were coming behind her. You move, Nana Lai. I said, what is this mouth that they are bending here? Say selfie. It's not selfie. You are selfish. Finally, now say, sir. I was angry. She now came to say, sir, I don't know if you can help me start. Come on, go. I should snap you. Are you all right? Leave the way. Say, okay, sir. Sir, just one. Let me just. It's my friend. Evaporate. Despite that, men don't come. You don't need catwalk. You need network. It is network that brings God's man. You want to get married to the man of your dream. You must admit that by beauty you shall not prevail. By your physical structure you can't prevail. By your eloquence and your oratory, your mastery of public speaking, you cannot prevail. Esther said, I don't need pancake. I don't need powder. While others were asking for makeup, Esther said, no, I need favor. The Bible said, and the king sat down. That king was a terrible king. The king just sat down and women were passing. King sat down. Say, bring all the virgins, let them pass. The first, imagine the first one coming. King, look at. Pass. Second one came. Say, because that lady doesn't know how to adjust. Hi, king. King said, pass. See the third one coming. That one just. King say, pass. You know, when you see some ladies now, that one, the fourth one come was carrying bag. Can I get a woman's bag here? When my mother gave birth to me, this is how my mother carry her bag, my mother. But today, every girl has stroke. What is this? Is this how to carry bag? If you want to carry bag. Then now look at stroke, paralysis. The whole bag like this. Sometimes the hand is up, sometimes the hand is down. But you have it like that, or you just stay like that. When you're on the road, you stay like that. You won't talk to somebody, you go like this. Who did this to you? And that one came with the bag. King said, pass. And somebody was coming. The king was getting tired. Esther was just coming, walking normally, connected to favor. The king,
Stop! Hey, while others are passing, they will tell you to stop, and they will favor you. While others are passing, they will tell you to stop, and they will bless you. While others are passing, they will tell you to stop, and they will remember you. If your amen is louder, take the blessing. If your amen is louder, take the blessing. If your amen is the loudest, take the blessing.
Take your seat. It has to be by the spirit, not by zodiac sign. Astrology. You see, I'm Scorpio. No wonder Scorpion is biting you. I'm Aquarius. No wonder you are in an aquarium. Why? Was there shame? The first. Why was there shame? How do you eradicate shame, rather? Invite Jesus. Number two, admit you are empty. Number three, he said, and they released the empty water pot. Tell somebody, give out something. Now let me shock you. If you know why people do not give, very easy. Two reasons. Number one, because they don't love God. Number two, they have no vision of their life. If you have a vision of your life, your vision is your mental picture of your actual future. When you have a vision for your life, what you want to become in life, no matter what you have now, you will understand that what you have now is nothing compared to where you are going. Life is a transaction. Give. Some years ago, in 1972, Malaysia wanted to buy over Singapore. You know Singapore? Malaysia wanted to buy over Singapore because Singapore was so poor. But a president in 1974, a prime minister then, he came up with a vision of what he wanted the state to be like. And he gave the first order. Number one, he said, all citizens, you must save 23% of your salary or go to jail. Because he discovered that one of their problems was that they were not living within their income. So they started saving 23% of their salary. If you get to Singapore now, as you are landing, there is, if you look, there's an inscription on the wall. All gun related offense punishable by death. All drug related offense punishable by death. All sex crime, rape, pedophiles punishable by death. Chewing gum and dropping it on the street, $1,000 or 24 lashes of the cane in public. Spitting on the street, $1,000 or 24. Before you enter, they will ask you, read, you read. They say, do you understand? You say, no. If not Chinese, you be. Somebody will come explain to you for Chinese. If not, do you understand? You say, no. They interpret, you don't understand. You say, no. They will turn your big bum bum or your flat ass at the airport, bundle you on the next flight back to your country. Somebody had a vision to change the state, to change the country. And today, Singapore is a world power. Vision. Why am I a giver? Why do I give? It's because there's a vision I have for my life. And I know that what is with me now is not enough to fulfill what I desire. I'm not a fool. People have given me names. Father Christmas. Mumu. When I started giving my cars, pastors call me fool. See this one? He just entered ministry. He's a fool. I've given over 300 cars. I'm not talking of cars. I bought with my money. Say, Mumu, you have started again. Fool. He's a fool. But I know what I'm doing. I know what I'm doing. I laid the foundation. April 29, 1998, I was sat down in Lagos asking God, is this how my life will be? And God said, I will make you an example of wealth in your generation. And through your wealth, many shall be mighty and wealthy. I said, what is the transaction? He said, giving. I began to give. The first car I had, that I used it for 2 weeks, and I gave it out. That same week, God gave me cars. I gave it. I remember one car, just Reverend John and Kingsley that we are around, in Council Hall. It was the Benz 190. God told me, give the car. That was the only car we had in the ministry. Worldwide. God said, give it out.
I talked to Kingsley. Kingsley said, no problem. I turned to my wife. I was looking for John because John is a business administrator. He calculates, very calculative. So I turned to John. I was expecting John would tell me, no, sir, pray again. When I turned to John, John said, if it's God, do it. Oh. I said, child, I'm in trouble. The morning I was leaving, the young man that was washing the car was crying.
He said, Daddy, I'm not sure it's God. I said, you should give this car.
I said, get out, get out, get out, get out. I gave her the car. Somebody came from Port Harcourt with all this office flat file in a document. Gave me a brand new car. We were about going for the morning session. And they told me, say, Eva, this thing is working. Oh. I said, I told you God is doing something. We dropped the car. While we went for the morning session, while we were coming back, a guy was chasing us with a BMW convertible. Chasing us. When we drove him to the hotel, he followed us. So one of the pastors jumped out. Where are you going? He said, I want to see the apostle. He said, you cannot see him. Come back.
The man said, I came to drop my car.
The pastor said, hey, you can see him. Come. Two cars. It was a Thursday. We were happy. Went back on Sunday in the church. We called a man of God to come and dedicate the car. The man now preached everlasting sermon. Dedicate motto. It's like he was just preaching. While he was preaching, God said, will you allow somebody to preach like this long? And not bless him. Give him the two cars. While he was going, I said, sir, leave with the cars. Three women stood up from the back and left the church. At the end of the service, one usher asked them, why did you leave? They said, our pastor has come mad. One day we'll be sitting down, he will just pack all of us, say, I saw you. Before they go sow me, make a find another church where they go. But today, listen, anything you give, you become bigger than. You are not stranded because you are in a civil service state. You are not stranded because you have not been paid. You are not stranded because of the economy of the country. You are stranded because you are stingy. In our ministry, when we do pastors' meeting, they can tell you, we don't discuss money. We don't discuss money. We've never discussed money as agenda. They say agenda of meeting. Have we ever? We don't discuss money. Say, okay, and this thing, how are we going to raise? We don't talk. It's not an issue. It's not. We don't discuss money. Things just happen on their own. We'll be going here. We'll be going here. We'll be going here. We don't discuss money. I go abroad at times with 29 people, 25 people. Sometimes we enter the plane and the airline say, it's just your people on this plane. Paid for. From my pocket. Not church. It means nothing to me. Am I communicating? Because it's my life. When God sees that kind of man, God says, give him money. He's using it well. I went to London. I finished preaching. People blessed me. £30,000 in my pocket. I knelt down. Oh, Lord, my God. Well, now you know some wonder. God said, put your hand down. Do you love me? I said, yes. He said, take that money and give it to a pastor. I said, Father, the tithe. He said, no, everything. I gave the pastor money. I expected him to collect the money and go. He started praying some very annoying prayer. He lifted the money and left. I said, Father, thank you. I thank you because you can inconvenience anybody for my sake. I said, who did God inconvenience for? Will you control your mouth? Who did God inconvenience for your sake? Started praying some annoying prayer. So I said, go. I was angry. Very angry. I entered the plane. I was frowning. When I landed, somebody called me. Say, this is Apostle Suleiman. I said, yes. He said, please, can you come to my house on the island? I said, you are very rude. You are very arrogant. It was a transfer of anger. I just gave money and this man is provoking me. You are very rude, arrogant. As you come to the island, I don't know you. I hung up the phone. The Holy Spirit told me, said, this is not right. A man of God must not strive. Call him back and apologize. So I said, sorry. Next time, don't do that. That's very proud. He said, okay, sir. Are you coming? Eh? I'm just correcting you. You are repeating the same thing. He said, are you on your way, sir? I said, send the drivers. They came. We left. I got in there. God opened my eyes and showed me what was happening. I told them they were crying, him and the wife. And they gave me a brown pack. It was an envelope. I held the money. I was interested. I dropped it.
I was thinking of what I gave. So I was going, I opened it. It was dollar bills. When I counted, it was $1 million. I had the money tight, had my Bible tight, because we are in the last days. When I was going, I was counting. I thought the driver was seeing me. We got to the place I was to put up at the Sheraton, and the driver said, "What time will I come tomorrow?" My flight was 7, so I told him, "Come by 9. Look, I didn't trust him. The way he was looking at me, I said, "Come by 9. He now said, "Is your flight not 7? I said, "So you even know the time?" Anybody that greeted me more than once was a suspect. That's why I hold on. Apostle, one lady was coming. Apostle, lay hands on me. I said, not today, not today, not today. I got to the airport and they say, "Apostle, what is that thing you are holding? Please bring it. Let us check it in." I say, check me in. Give this envelope a seat. Me, tag me and check me in. I got into the plane and the Lord said, "Johnson, do you love me?" I say, "Yes." Say, "Give me that money." "What have you given?" "Car." And you are, people give car, they are crying. "Ooh, carry your toy. Carry your car. The carburetor is even bad. Injector is not working. All the rims have eaten up. No shaft. No shocker. Carry your moto." A lady had television. She was crying. She said, "Lord, this is my sacrifice. This is my sacrifice." Usher, come. The hotel pastor. You know, they won't go. May they repair them. This is my sacrifice. People will run. They will drop answer during message. Drop the answer and they will go back with the charger. A young man came out and dropped charger or phone. He dropped charger. He left with the phone. I said, "Young man, come here. Thus said the Lord, carry your property here." I gave that to God. What was I expressing? A function of love. Stop all this. I give so that God will bless me. Give because you love God. No Christian service is complete without sacrificial living. You are not married today because you have not yet loved God enough to give. God said, "You cannot give me your car. Why will I give you a husband? You cannot give me that which is precious." God said, "Stay where you are." That's the problem we have. Your pastor, Pastor Hodges, came to my house one time. I don't know what's here now. And he came to greet me. He was going back. He didn't come with a car, he just came. While he was going, I said, "How are you going?" He said, "Don't worry, I will board the bike." I said, "No, go to the compound. Carry any car you like. And you trust him." He trusted him. He went and collected one kind of car. When me, I see the car, my mind caught. I said, "Don't return it, take it." Whatever you can give, you outgrow. A church was saying they want to buy land in Benin, and I was preaching. I said, "Which area?" They said, "GRE." I said, "Oh, thank you, Jesus." He said, "What?" I said, "I have a land around that area. It's even 2 times of what you want." He said, "Okay, sir. So how much do we pay you?" I said, "Pay me for land that they will build church." No, how can somebody have a land and church is looking for a land? Are you not stupid? Church, they find land and you get land. A church is built on your land. Your children. My children don't fall sick. My children never fall sick. Covenant covers them. Sometimes I ask myself, these children safe? They know they have this maybe headache or one small money. No. Covenant. Their father has established altars. Land. Let me ask you a question. OFM now is in Owerri. OFM now is in Imo. Somebody now carry land and meet Oji and say, "This is 1 hectare of land." You should even be happy for the man to collect. A man gave me a building, and I said to him, go and thank God that I collected it. I said, I don't need it. And that is the truth, oh. I'm not in that league of pastors. I understand it like I know my name. While the earth remains, seed time, harvest, cold, heat, day, night, summer, winter. Our auditors, we have auditing our church account, and they saw some heavy millions in the account. They asked me, Daddy, you saw an inflow from your account. How did it come? I said, I only know editors are angry when money is missing. That's why auditors are angry. Now you are seeing many money, you are complaining. Audit it. I said, you should be angry if money is missing. Now you are seeing millions. Inflow. You should be happy. Don't ask me question. It's between me and God. God spoke to me to do that. One time God said to me, can you give me 10 million? I said, Lord, when? Not when. One time God asked me, can you give me 100 million? I said, Father, with my phone now, we'll do it. Call my bank. I said, wire 100 million to church account. No prayer, no talk, no stress. There are certain levels of power you cannot enter until you are a sacrificial giver. If you like, go to mountain, fast. Burn your stomach. I'm telling you, that level of power is connected to a sacrificial seed. Have you seen, you can't pray. Have you seen on the mountain? If you go to Rio K, mountain, you see prayer. You can't catch up with them. Oh, wow! Oh, you can't catch up. Oh. You better do what they are not doing. Am I communicating? The Bible says, Abel offered, Cain brought. Is that deep? Is that deep? Abel offered, Cain brought. To Cain, it was casual. To Abel, it was sacrificial. I want to pray for you. I want to pray for you. I want to take you to the, listen to me. I want to take you to a level where money will lose value. When if God tells you to give, you give. If it's not painful, it will not be gainful. Imagine a multi-millionaire will carry 500,000 and this man is a mega millionaire. I said, that's a seed. That's no seed. That's an offering. It's like me now carrying 5 million. Ooh, it's not a seed to me. 5 million is not a seed. 10 million is not a seed to me. 20 million is not a seed to me. It's not a seed. A wealthy man in this country, very wealthy, he stayed around me for just 6 hours. He said, Apostle, you give money than politicians. He said, I sit around you and I'm afraid. He said, you give. He said, we who are politicians on national level. He said, do you know I've calculated 16 million has left you the past 6 hours? This one 500, this one 300, this one 200. He said, that's why I had to call my wife that, hey, if God doesn't use this man, I will protest. If God does not use him, I will protest. I said, sir, not be say I to get him all. It is a heart. You must first have the heart before the cash. You must first have the heart. And it starts with your little level. Stand up on your feet, everybody. Yeah.